What a court hath old England of folly and sin. Spite of Chatham and Camden, Bar, Berks, Wilk and Glynn. Not content with the Game Act, they tax fish and sea, and America drenched with hot water and tea.
A great war with France for the mastery of the continent had at long last ended. England was victorious, but her colonies were restive. They wanted the redcoats to go home. They resented new governmental regulations and controls. But Britain's greatly enlarged empire saddled her with new burdens and greater expenses. She needed more revenue. How was it to be gotten? Englishmen believed they were taxed to the hilt. Britain's first Lord of the Treasury, George Grenville, felt that America should pay its fair share of the cost of operating the empire. The result? New taxes, a sugar act on imports, which was strictly enforced, and a stamp act, which imposed a tax upon newspapers, almanacs, legal documents, and even playing cards. This was direct taxation by Parliament, something Parliament had never done before. In the Virginia House of Burgesses in Williamsburg, a young upcountry lawyer presented a series of resolves protesting the stamp act. In fiery language, he defied the king and his ministers. According to later accounts, he exclaimed in a voice of thunder,
"Caesar had his Brutus, Charles the First his Cromwell, and George the Third..."
"Treason! Treason! Treason!"
"May profit by their example. If this be treason, make the most of it."
Echoes of Patrick Henry's voice resounded throughout the land. A Stamp Act Congress was convened at New York in October 1765. Congress denounced taxation without representation. Its resolves closely followed the arguments advanced by John Dickinson of Pennsylvania.